today, and it's the last leg of the series. Tonight, we'll be joined live by Britain's comedy superstar, Eddie Izzard. We ask the question, to veil or not to veil? And we find out why Josh is doing this.
It's Joshy!
On the show that has massive balls. Last leg of the series, the show that refuses to queue overnight for a copy of Grand Theft Auto, but would happily wait 5 hours for a game of Sabutio. With me on the couch, as always, are Dartmoor's finest, Josh Widdicombe, and the man who thinks Vince Cable is a type of sweater, Alex Brooker. Welcome back to the show where assassination attempts happen as we are on. That is right, people. Like,
I mean, who could we have annoyed? Japan? Russia?
I'm just relieved you're alive, Adam. Right? The worst thing is Alex dived behind me.
That was a balloon, everyone. And if you're watching at home on Sky Plus, rewind a bit and you can see the moment a little bit of wee came out.
That couldn't have been better timed. It was literally 10 seconds into the show. Anyway, Adam, get on with it. We've got a show to do, mate.
Now, look, we've received a lot of tweets this week about an image we left you with last week that just got a round of applause in the room again. It was Alex impersonating Miley Cyrus on a wrecking ball.
There was a lot of tweets complaining that Alex had worn pants.
Yes.
I have the opposite complaint. I think you should have been wearing a lot more.
Just for any women that were watching that, you can find me on Facebook and also I'm on the Twitter, Instagram and Bebo.
You know, one guy actually tweeted me directly saying, is it okay that I picture that to try and prolong sex? And then said, is it okay it has the opposite effect?
That was me that tweeted that.
By the way, the next time you think you've had a bad day at work, spare a thought for this guy.
It looks like one of those photos they smuggle out of Guantanamo Bay.
When I went out on set, took my kit off and they just said, look, we're going to need a bloke under you to hold your ball. I'm backing out of this. I'm not doing this.
Now, listen, the other thing we did last week, which was we made a speech to inspire a man called Richard Whitehead, who's attempting to run 40 marathons across Britain in 40 days for charity. Yesterday, we decided to put our motivation where our mouth is. We headed out to rainy Somerset to try and get him through the last few days. We'll show you how it went later in the show, but, okay, here's what happened. Three of us on the back of a truck in the middle of Somerset... to try and cheer on Richard, couldn't find him.
No, it turns out Somerset is bigger than you think, isn't it? We'll meet you in Somerset.
we couldn't find him. We held traffic up for about 10 minutes in the middle of the street.
The worst bit was Alex was on the back of the truck. At one point, he turned to me and he went, "This would be perfect for egging."
I mean, literally.
When you learn your lesson.
You had like 360-degree, like, could have gone from anywhere. But I mean, I don't know how we didn't find him. It's not like, where's Wally? I mean, he's got two prosthetic legs, you know. Kind of, he stands out a little bit.
Well, that was the best thing, because we then went with him around Somerset, in front of him, trying to entertain him. You'll see it later in the show. But the great thing is, traffic was banked up for like 2 or 3 miles. And it was amazing watching people finally overtaking. And you could see them angry, and then go, why? Why the hell have I been? Oh, it's a man with no legs. I can't complain. I'll keep going.
And then they were hit by an egg from Alex.
We will show that later in the show, but listen, it is our last show of the year. We've done 2 series this year. It's certainly our last show of the series. So we thought tonight, as a poll, we want to know, who do you think has been the dick of the year?
It wasn't the game!
I wasn't pointing, I was just stretching.
That last leg, hashtag at Dick of the Year. We will take your nominations.
Can I just say, it's not just us three?
Not at all. I mean,
And also, as well, that's tweets, not photos and whatnot. Let's not get silly with this, people. This is an Instagram.
Yeah, OK. Yeah, yeah. Preferably people from the news, not just my mate Eric.
My mate's cheating on his girlfriend.
Oh, yeah, and tweet us why they're dicks as well. Let us know. Listen, as always, we attempt to answer the big is it OKs on this show. For example, is it OK that a supermarket in Cardiff sold a cheese and onion pasty containing meat to a Muslim family? No. Is it OK that they then apologised by offering them champagne? That is the first double no we've had in this show. Look, in a similar vein, a lot of people were asking, is it OK about one topic in particular this week, including Finn, who said, is it OK that a Muslim woman has to remove her veil to give evidence in court?
This woman cannot be identified for legal reasons and because she's wearing a full face veil. She was determined to wear it during her forthcoming trial. A judge ruled that when giving evidence, at least, she will have to take it off.
Politicians, including the Prime Minister, have weighed in.
And if more women are to wear the veil, there will surely also be many more disputes like this one.
Yes, this week a Muslim woman was told her traditional niqab was inappropriate court attire by a man dressed in red robes, gold chains and a woman's wig. lads, how do we feel about this?
Well, as you know, Adam, you know, all my opinions are well thought through and well researched, so I feel like the perfect person to kick us off on this topic of religion.
I think we'll be off air within 30 seconds.
I think what my thought is that, like, I don't think anybody should have to remove the veil,
yeah,
as, like, when they're given evidence, unless, of course, the veil is evidence. In which case, you're going to have to, aren't you?
Alex Brooker there with an opinion I don't think we've heard anywhere else this week. Josh?
I tried.
Same as him. No. I think it was a weird one, wasn't it? Because the reason they gave was that you need to be able to see the person's facial expression, but that's not how you decide a court case. It's evidence. Well, you don't go, well, there's no evidence, but you look shifty. Unless they're going, did you do the murder? No. Not a murderer.
What did they think she was doing under the veil? I'm completely innocent.
And to the jury?
And look, there is an opinion that a lot of people are saying, but you know, these are women who are forced into wearing the veils and that's why they shouldn't be forced to dress a certain way. But then there are other people who dress that way that go, well, no, this is how I choose to dress. So I think there should be like an opt-in or opt-out option, perhaps. And you could let people know, no, this is how I choose to dress. Like a little blue tick you get on Twitter. And you know what I mean? And you can someone walk past the street in the veil and you go, yeah, oh no, you choose that, that's fine. You're not being forced.
I think they should have the same with Crocs. You're choosing to dress like that and you're definitely a bell end.
Yeah, I mean, that's the sort of thing like people saying about all the veils and that, they find it offensive in public. That, yeah, the Crocs and that, like, people wear them geek T-shirts. I find that offensive. People who wear those glasses when they don't need glasses because they're trying to look hip. Like, that's taking the piss. I have to go to Boots for mine, do you know what I mean?
And look, as far as
I missed that.
So did I. What did I miss then? OK, we'll move on. My opinion, I think we should either accept all religions or reject them all. We either say you can wear whatever you want or you can't wear anything at all, which is what they've done in other countries. And personally...
What, naked?
No. But I mean, you know, in some countries you can't wear even a crucifix, you can't wear a veil. But I think I'd like to go the opposite way. I'd like to go, yeah, everyone, wear whatever you want. On the condition, I think she should be able to wear a veil in court on the condition that anyone that ticks Jedi on the last census has to dress as Obi-Wan Kenobi in court. And give... and maybe answer like Yoda. Where were you on the night of the murder?
At home was I.
Thankfully, the Sun dealt with it with its usual combination of sensitivity and tact. Ah, the sun, we can always count on you to take a culturally sensitive spark and fan it till it becomes a bonfire of hate. Look, I'll be honest, I didn't read it, but I assume it went, I don't think any woman should be told how to look, said Candy, 23, from Exeter, as she... displayed the fake breasts and spray tan needed to make her way through the modelling industry. I don't know. There's so much about it this week. Do you think veils should be allowed in court or in public?
I think the Sun view that, or the government also said, like, that you can, they're going to leave it open to institutions. But that's kind of passing the buck, isn't it? Because you're just, look, I'm not going to enforce it in my house. But then I struggle to enforce the shoes off policy. So.
Another tweet came in from Kevin Sanderson this week saying, is it okay to buy Grand Theft Auto just to drive around in tanks blowing up hookers?
I hope he means on the game.
For those of you who don't know, Grand Theft Auto is a video game in which your character has to rise through the ranks of the criminal underworld by killing, stealing, shooting, and generally acting immorally. Might not surprise you to know it was invented in Scotland. Joke.
Is there anyone left you haven't offended?
This week, the next instalment of the game was released with a budget of around £170 million, more than most Hollywood blockbusters. Now, supposedly, and look, it is actually appropriate that it was made in Scotland because it's a satire on America, OK? It's meant to send up American culture, but it's come under fire for glamorising violence. Alex, you're a gamer. What do you think?
People keep saying that Grand Theft Auto incites like anger and violence. That doesn't. I'll tell you what does. SingStar. Because I'll tell you one thing. I can sing NSYNC, bye bye bye, perfectly. Do I ever get a perfect score? Do I balls? It's absolute bullshit. I'm sick of it. The amount of tiny holes I've punched in my door.
Here's an interesting one, and this has been going around for a while. Graham Brown said, is it okay that Atos are telling people with cerebral palsy that their condition will improve? Now, if you don't know, Atos are a French company employed by the British government to test whether people on disability benefits deserve them. This week, an Atos report on someone with cerebral palsy suggested further assessments were necessary because her disability was expected to improve. Now, I don't know how much you know about cerebral palsy, Atos. It does not improve. That's the equivalent of a coroner assessing someone as dead, then suggesting further tests every 6 months because the level of death may ease off. Here's a phrase no one's ever used, Atos. You know, Susan from down the road, her cerebral palsy just cleared up. Turned out she just needed to eat more eggs. Do you know what I'm saying, Atos? You're being dicks. And the thing is, you don't have to look that far to find someone affected by a dodgy Atos assessment or disability assessment in any sense. Alex, you've had it.
No, Alex is disabled.
No, I know, but... See, it's just like, you know, I got a letter through.
Yeah.
So, like, in 6 months, they're going to reassess me because my condition might improve. And I thought I might have got the wrong end of six. I've been getting excited. I mean, I've been going out buying gloves all week. Is that not what it means? I mean, I bought sandals.
The thing is, Atos are sponsors of next year's Commonwealth Games and the Associated Paralympic Games. No British athlete is going to want to win. You cross the line, pick up a gold medal, and they immediately cut your benefits. It's one of those things that you want to do something about it, but you just don't know what to do. And I didn't know what to do about it this week, but then I took some inspiration from something that happened in Northern Ireland. In the middle of a sectarian hotspot this week, someone painted the slogan, "Join the IRA," on the side of a prominent building. Now, during the night, a local wag, and as far as I'm concerned, a hero, rejected violent reprisals or destructive behaviour. He added to the message with this. It now says, join the library. So here's what I'm thinking. Next year, when Atos have their name plastered all over posters around the country telling us what a great job they're doing for the games, take out your felt tip pen and add a few words before their name to create a whole new sentence. Disability? We clearly don't give a toss. We are looking for your nominations for the Dick of the Year. Tweet us at The Last Leg, hashtag at Dick of the Year. We've had a few that suggest Josh. Come on, people, come on. I know.
Is it your fault?
It is.
Oh, sorry, mate.
What, someone suggested the Dick of the Year is Tian Tian the panda for not giving birth. Sentiment will collate them by the end of the show. It is time now to introduce our guest. He is quite simply a comedy superstar. From the Hollywood Bowl to Wembley Arena, from the Riches to Ocean's 12, he's the star of stage and screen. He is Eddie Izzard!
I just got to say, I gave everyone hugs just because I haven't met you guys before, but, you know, it's a hug thing.
It is.
And so, because we've known each other for years, you know, since 1418 war, I think.
Yes.
Florian lost his leg.
I have been, for a number of reasons, I've been thinking about you this week, because you were the first person to ever show me an iPhone.
Right,
before
yes.
anybody else had them.
Yeah.
And now the new one's coming out soon. Are you still as excited as you were back then?
I'm slightly less excited on this one, but I did get the iPad not knowing why I was getting the iPad. But I was a kid. I was a, you know, it's toys for adults, toys for boys and toys for girls.
Yep.
You know, I've got enough money to do it. And the iPad, when I got it and I thought, I don't know what this does and I don't know what it is, but I've got it. And then I gradually realized, oh, you can read books on it. Ah, that's good. And you can see films on it and it's better than the small one. And so I gradually worked out why I'd bought it. That was a really...
You've been using it as a tray for months. Yeah.
So I'd just say you would love Candy Crush.
What's Candy Crush?
It's a little game.
Well, how do you feel about Grand Theft Auto this week? Because that's pretty violent. That's pretty.
Wait, what? Just it's another one, or was anything special about it, or is it just it's come again?
It's come again. It's the latest one. It's more violent.
I'm sure I could get into them a bit, like, you know, those reality shows which, oh, I hate these reality shows. Oh, and then you start watching, oh, I've got to watch this, oh, I've got to keep it on. So I'm scared that I would get into Grand Theft Auto. But
only if the people you were shooting had done something wrong. Like,
they had to be Nazis or zombies. Then I would be fine with it because I have a thinking brain.
Now, there's another...
Well, that's it, isn't it? You know, it's... Because I did want to be in the army when I was a kid, and then I...
Wow, what went wrong with that?
Well, I knew I couldn't do transvestite and the military, that wasn't going to work. But I was like that. My whole career is military strategy.
I'm pretty sure anyone that turns up...
That's true. How do you get a career as a transvestite? It wasn't the standard thing. The standard thing was don't come out, lie about it the rest of your life, and be ashamed and be fearful and be guilty. And I self-analyze myself.
As a street entertainer, I need to ask you this, as coming during the week. Someone wrote in, is it okay if I take this costume off now? # Northampton clown. Now, are you aware of this? There has been a clown spotted in Northampton.
I was in Canada yesterday, I'm going to Canada, and they talked about the clown in Canada.
Really?
And then when I came in, I Googled, I have my phone in French because I'm, you know, learning French, you get all the technical words. If you're learning a language, by the way, put it into the language because you get all the technical words come up. And so the first thing when I Google comes up in French, and the French are talking about it. Yeah,
and
you know.
He looks like this, for those of you who don't know. This guy's just been spotted. There he is, just outside a house in Northampton, just hanging there. No reason. There he is, just outside someone else's house, just waving, in the main street. There's no reason.
Northampton looks terrible, doesn't it?
He's the mayor.
In America, the Hamptons are this big thing. Everyone goes to the Hamptons for a summer, and it's the Hamptons. You know this thing.
Yeah.
So it's a big thing in America. Doesn't mean that, because we've got Northampton, Southampton, and Wolverhampton. And.
We had Boris Johnson, Mayor of London, on a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
And you have suggested that you may run for Mayor of London in the future.
Yeah, 2020.
We did ask him for any tips for you.
Right.
This is what he came up with.
Okay.
Boris.
Sure.
We've got Eddie Izzard on in 2 weeks.
Oh, good. He's very good, yeah.
Who may, you know, maybe the next London mayor.
Oh, yes,
you.
Well,
what
yes,
advice
yes.
would you give a comedian getting into politics like Eddie Izzard?
Well, just go for it. Go for your life. Don't be put off when people laugh at you.
Well, he has made made it a lot easier for me to go into politics. I said that. Someone said, how can you, as a comedian, go into politics? I said, Boris Johnson. He said, yeah, okay. That was a journalist, and that was the length of the conversation. It really was that, and they just gave up. So, you know, because he cracks a joke. Because politics needs comedy in there, but at the end of paragraphs, because you're talking about serious things.
Yeah, right.
And you need the comedy. And I don't use it anywhere in my stand-up, because I'm actually quite positive on politics, and it's no good as a... comedy is no good as a positive thing. It's an attack weapon. Yeah. It undermines the opposition. So I constantly say that the Tory party are basically like the Dementors from Harry Potter. They want to suck your face off, and I can't prove this scientifically, but we all know it's true. And everyone just laughs, you know, and that's where comedy comes into it.
You actually gave out a medal, medals at the Paralympics
yes.
this year. You were really... I saw a speech online where you really fired up the Games Makers as well, which was
well,
amazing.
I was sort of ambassador slash cheerleader for Games Makers, and I knew I wanted to be here for the Olympics, and I ran my last 43rd marathon past the Olympic Stadium specifically, and I even checked it out beforehand to find one place where you could see the whole Olympic Stadium. There's a flyover just at the end, yeah. Just at the corner of it, the southwest corner. So I'd got all the way there, and I was totally into it, and I just went around trying to... encourage the Games Makers. A lot of them weren't in the main stadium. They were doing jobs that no one saw, so I just thought they did a phenomenal job, and they got huge standing ovations at all the closing ceremonies.
And we kind of did our own version of it during the week, because Richard Whitehead, who was one of the heroes of last year's Paralympics, this year he's going a step better. He is attempting to run 40 marathons in 40 days across Britain to raise money for charity. Now, last week we told you that he'd been watching Chariots of Fire whilst he's running to get himself fired up. So yesterday, Alex, Josh and I ventured out to a very rainy Somerset to see if we could entertain him as he ran in our own inimitable fashion. Richard, we've come out here to get you through the next leg of your marathon. We are going to act out movie scenes for you on the back of this truck. Your job is to try and name the movies we're acting out.
Here's Joshy!
That might be The Shining.
Yeah!
Are you swimming backstroke? Matrix!
Every night in my dreams, I see you, I see you.
Get the tongues in there.
Answer! Oh,
no, keep going. Oh. Keep going. Titanic! Basic instinct. Fucking hell, what?
Richard, it's quite difficult for us on here in the rain, so if you could do anything to keep our spirits up, that would be a real bonus.
It's the circle of life in the pissing rain. Lion King.
All right, lads, last one. I've saved the best till last.
No.
Yes. I'm not doing that.
This is not my contract.
Finding Nemo. Make it a human centipede.
I don't know. Paralympic legacy.
Richard, 40 marathons in 40 days. Not only that, you have just identified every movie we have tried to act out for you.
In the pissing rain.
You are truly a superhuman.
People tell me that I've got my head too far up your ass, but that was taking the piss.
It's great. You can see people driving past us kind of going, is that the guys from the last leg doing the human centipede? And now, when you ran your marathons, which you did... And by the way, Richard is running on behalf of Sarcoma UK and Scope. Details on how to donate are on the Last League page on the Channel 4 website. And do you know what? He's on Twitter. His handle is @MarathonChamp. Send him as many messages of as support as you can, because he's only got about 6 days to go. When you ran in your marathons, did you have... Like your toe, I read somewhere that you had to have like maybe half a toe removed. Was that right?
No. They just shredded. But my thing is nothing compared to what he's doing. But I was watching Chariots of Fire as well. Chariots of Fire, big movie for me way back, and I had it, and I would watch it most days.
Chariots really, of Fire. As you were running, right?
Yeah. I didn't listen to any music, and he's not listening to music. I don't know if you ever look. But you know, before I had this idea, before I did it, that I would listen to music, like you know, something like Chariots of Fire. But and then I no, just so, listen to.
How, what did you do to keep your mind on it when you were...
Well, I've got this crazy mind that's got... And, you know, if you're a stand-up, you want to talk about something. And I would run past the Battle of Naseby, and then I'd go, the Battle of Naseby. So on this very road, it wasn't obviously tarmac then, but then there must have been the cavalry coming down, and Cromwell would come down, and then Prince Rupert would come down for the... you know, I was imaging all that stuff, and then sometimes it wouldn't happen, and sometimes I got a bit bored, but...
Just before we wrap up for our last show of the series, your top five dicks of the year were Tian Tian the Panda for not giving birth, Katie Hopkins, who was self-nominating, and Justin Bieber, Jim Davidson, your dick of the year, ladies and gentlemen, Vladimir Putin.
I didn't top that poll.
Listen, that's all we've got time for the final last leg of the series. Would you please thank our guest for tonight, Eddie Izzard? And for my partners in crime, Josh Widdicombe and Alex Brooker. Before we sign off tonight, I'd just like to give a huge thank you to all the floor crew, behind-the-scenes staff, producers and associates involved in this show, all of whom help us to look like we know what we're doing. Thank you as well to you at home for your tweets. Thanks to all our guests and thanks to the newsmakers who have given us so much to talk about over the last couple of months. No one knows what will happen to the people in the news for the rest of the year, but we'd like to leave you tonight with how we think their year might have panned out. Thanks for watching The Last Leg. My name's Adam Hills. See you soon for the next leg. Putin came out of the closet in November 2013. He now lives with US Secretary of State John Kerry in a Siberian love nest. Miley Cyrus earned the wrath of the Muslim world when she performed her trademark sexy dance while clad head to toe in traditional clothing. The twerker has since taken the world by storm. Richard Whitehead is still trying to get the image of Josh, Alex and Adam doing the human centipede out of his head. Josh Widdicombe reacted badly when he learnt that he is actually the illegitimate love child of Boris Johnson. He reacted worse when Alex referred to his mum as a Boris bike. Brian May's Badger, Badger, Badger song became a Christmas number one. In an attempt to get the song out of their heads, the Badgers culled themselves. Alex Brooker has left comedy and now works in the construction industry. The head of the props department is suing for sexual harassment. So is the wrecking ball.